We're here at this event because our planet needs our help. The Earth is warming at an alarming rate, and we have not yet made sufficient progress reversing this trend. The magnitude of the problem is increasingly clear, but solutions remain difficult to implement at sufficient scale. A core driver of this is that since the start of the Industrial Revolution, GDP and emissions have grown hand in hand. This chart shows that development, with emissions in the red line and GDP in blue. This easy growth fueled by carbon is the only growth that we have known for generations and resulted in massive lifestyle improvements for much of the world, which makes it difficult to let go of. But for the global economy to break this link and meet any sort of emissions reductions target, we need a new type of growth, growth that decouples economic gains from emissions. My team views this decoupling between emissions and growth as the greatest investing opportunity of our lifetimes. We invest in exceptional teams applying emerging technologies to traditional industries sustainably. We support climate tech companies across sectors that facilitate a new type of green growth. Fortunately, this economy-wide transition has taken root, and I'm here today to share why climate tech touches upon everything and everyone. Now, if you look carefully at this chart, you'll see that the emissions and GDP lines have already begun to cross. This has been driven primarily by a shift in the energy sector. Before the broader term climate tech was mainstream, a wave of entrepreneurs and investors were working on combating climate change using clean energy. This wave, which we call Clean Tech 1.0, peaked around 15 years ago and was focused primarily on the transition from fossil fuels to renewables, such as solar and wind. This was a powerful starting point, given that energy accounts for 25% of global emissions. The journey was not always easy. A lot of money was lost through the first wave of clean tech investing, but fortunately, many continue to innovate. And these innovations, as well as cost reductions that come from scale, have gotten us to a point where renewables are cheaper than fossil fuels in many contexts, facilitating their adoption economy-wide, including by those who don't necessarily care about the sustainability benefits. But fixing the energy system alone is not enough. My team invested in this first wave of clean tech, and we continue to make energy investments today, but realized more than a decade ago that there's so much more to the challenge than just energy. The next sector we started to tackle was transportation, which accounts for up to 20% of global emissions. We developed a vision around mobility as a service, moving from a world where individuals were owning internal combustion engine vehicles that they were driving less than 5% of the time, to a future of transportation that is shared, autonomous, electric, and connected, and moving people and goods around the world in a cleaner and more efficient manner. Climate tech and transportation means electric vehicles and the infrastructure to charge them, and supply chains for core components such as batteries, from mining raw materials all the way to recycling at the end of the battery's life. It means LiDAR and cameras and other sensors to make our vehicles autonomous and connected so that they are safer, can communicate with each other, and run more efficiently. It means software and hardware to help people share their vehicles, to improve our logistical planning so that cars and trucks are not driving around half empty and we are not producing more vehicles than we need. We've also been tackling food and agriculture, another 20%+ of global emissions. Over 1/3 of all food that is grown is wasted. The average food item on the US dinner plate traveled more than 1,500 miles and changed hands 4 to 8 times. Just the nitrogen fertilizer supply chain is responsible for over 2% of global greenhouse gas emissions. Climate tech and agriculture means biological alternatives to replace synthetic fertilizers. Precision agriculture that uses data to give each piece of land its optimal treatment, and improvements in the fresh produce supply chain to reduce waste and minimize the distance that food is transported. It means plant and cell-based protein, automation across all steps of the value chain, and inventory management. Next is industrials and manufacturing, a $65 trillion market which accounts for approximately 25% of emissions. A decades-long shift from analog to digital is enabling companies to manufacture more efficiently and do more with less. A key driver here is the explosion of internet-connected devices, from just 40 million in 2011 to over 6 billion today. Now, climate tech in industrials and manufacturing means robotics and automated equipment to drive more efficient warehouse operations, augmented reality systems that help humans do better work, reducing errors and wasted output, sensors that detect equipment malfunctions prior to failure, allowing for preventative maintenance that extends equipment lifespan, apps that make our phones increasingly powerful and able to take on tasks that previously needed dedicated devices, and cleaner processes to produce everything from cement to steel. The most recent sector that we have embraced is retail and e-commerce. Fashion is responsible for over 10% of global emissions. One-third of all apparel products are never sold, and every year, 21 billion pounds of unwanted retail products end up in landfills. Climate tech and retail means technology to better understand consumer preferences so that we only produce what people actually want. More durable materials so that clothing can last longer, processes to make reselling and reusing clothes easier, allowing products to be used until the end of their usable life, and effective supply chains to redirect return products to those who can best use them. I'm sharing these examples with you all today, not necessarily because we are confident that we've identified all the best opportunities in climate tech, but rather to showcase the broad range of sectors and technologies that are a part of the picture. We are constantly exploring new possibilities as well. So here are a few that we find particularly promising for the future. Carbon markets across all sectors of the economy. More than a third of the world's largest publicly traded companies, from Amazon and Google to Shell and Exxon, have net zero targets, up from just a fifth a few years ago. These companies, and many more who will set targets in the years to come, need help with carbon accounting, understanding how much they are emitting, where these emissions come from, and how to reduce them. Many are also interested in carbon offsets, including removal technologies that can actively absorb carbon from the atmosphere and store it in permanent reservoirs. Carbon markets are fairly new, but nearing almost $1 trillion of value, presenting a large and growing opportunity. Another example is the future of work. Many of us spend more than half of our waking hours working. Where we work and how we work has a massive impact on our personal carbon footprints, because everything from our transportation infrastructure to the buildings we occupy to the habits of day-to-day lives are shaped by our working habits. We are exploring what climate tech means in this space and how to make the future of work more sustainable. Think back to when the internet was first invented. There was a small subset of internet companies and internet investors, separate from much of the rest of the economy. But if you fast forward to today, the internet permeates everything we do. It touches on every sector and almost every business. A similar transition is happening and will continue to happen in climate tech, because everything that we do impacts and is impacted by climate. A key to the success of this transition is that the future it creates must be better than the present. While charity and altruism play important roles in our society, they will not be able to scale to the magnitude of the climate challenge. Policy and regulatory frameworks also provide crucial scaffolding, but aren't sufficient. Our best chance of success is building profitable businesses that can scale with positive unit economics and customers that love the product. Businesses that are great financially and great for the environment, aligning self-interests with planetary interests across sectors. We believe that while there may be some growing pains in the short term, the future with climate tech ultimately will be not just greener, but better, more dependable energy, faster and more pleasant transportation, tastier and healthier food, higher quality products, and more enjoyable work. Another key to success for such an economy-wide transition is that everyone needs to be involved. This can mean starting companies, transitioning the business processes of existing companies, making sustainable choices as consumers, influencing regulators, or investing in and helping to build the next generation of innovative technologies across a wide variety of industries. Ultimately, In order to be successful in an enduring way, the future of climate tech must involve both everything and everyone.